Hi, I'm Dr. Charlie Weiss from the Bradley Hills Animal Hospital, and today I want to talk a little bit about post-operative care. This is a question that we get frequently anytime a pet has had surgery or had some kind of procedure in our hospital, and I want to try to clarify things and answer as many questions that I can in this video to be able to help you guys and make a difference when your pet has had a procedure or has had surgery. There are several elements post-operatively to think about. And the first one is incision care. Now, there are many different procedures we do, anything from teeth cleaning to spays and neuters to tumor removals to many other surgeries. So because there are so many different types of surgeries, I think it's important to talk about some of the post-operative principles or guidelines. And because there are so many different types of procedures and there are so many different species that we operate on, and even among any one species, dogs and cats and small mammals, they're all in different body conditions. Some of them have thinner skin, some of them have thicker skin, some of them may have lumps or things that are more vascular. So there's a wide variety, even among the same species, how an incision will look, for example. But I want to talk about some principles or some guidelines that you can carry over no matter what the species is, no matter what the procedure is. So the first area we're going to deal with is the incision care. So there are times that there is no incision. For teeth cleaning procedures and for some other procedures, there may not be an incision, but when there is an incision, there are several things to think about. One thing that I think is really important is when you pick your pet up, it's good to actually look at the incision or see what it looks like. And I know that we have a wide variety of clients, and I know that everything from people that may not be comfortable looking at the incision, I mean, gross them out, that may be something they just can't or won't do, and I understand that and I get that. And then to the other end of the spectrum, where there are physician clients, surgeon clients that see these things every day in humans or in other species. We have clients that are even veterinarians and are either in research or focus on other areas of veterinary medicine, where they'll bring their pets here for surgery. So there's a wide variety, but looking at the incision for changes is really important. So it's important to see the incision as soon as you can. And that would mean when you're here in the office, as you're checking out, that's the ideal time to see what the incision looks like. And if you think about this, when a pet has surgery and they go home either the same day or sometimes the next day, and their mom and dad come to pick them up, they're really excited, they're bouncing around many times, their blood pressure's up, and when they're excited like that, sometimes they're so excited they'll bump the incision, so sometimes there will even be a spot of blood on the incision, and that can happen from excitement, and that carries over even to when they're home, so it's good to know that. But it's good to check the incision. So what you're looking for are changes in the incision. When you look at an incision will be on their skin somewhere on their body, and the incision should be closed, but it's normal and possible for there to be a little bit of inflammation around the incision, so there may be redness or inflammation. The incision, some of the incisions will leave a little tiny gap for discharge, or will leave a little drain hole below or above the incision. Some of the incisions we close completely. So it's good to see the incision early on so you know what it looks like when your pet's going home. So that way you can see if there are any changes. And changes are the things that is significant. So if the incision is a little bit red around it, sometimes that's normal. That could be the normal way a skin will react to an incision. And they may look at the incision a little bit, may cause it to be a little bit red. So that may be part of the healing process. But if you check it every day or a couple of times a day, and if you see the redness expanding, or if you see lines that are red going down, going along from the incision, and it's a change, or something is changing, that would be significant. The incision also should stay closed. So there, incisions can be closed in many different ways, and each case is different. Some cases have sutures. Some of our cases we close with staples. They're metal staples. They then come out in 2 weeks, like the sutures do. Some of them are closed with suture material under the skin. So sometimes you see nothing external, but you see it. You see the skin closed. You see the line where the incision is, and you don't see anything on top. It's another possibility. Sometimes incisions can be closed with tissue glue. There's sterile tissue glue that we use for some of the small incisions. So there are many different ways it can be closed, and it's important to look at it initially or as early as you can, and then check it every day or twice a day. And if you see an opening, if there's an opening in the incision, it's always best to call us. If the incision has a gap that, where if it looks like there's a staple or a suture that's missing, which that's possible, because a dog or a cat, if they want to, if they lick enough or chew enough at an incision, it doesn't take much for them to chew out sutures or staples. So it's possible, and that's why it's important to try to minimize their licking or try to limit them from licking at incisions. But if you see an opening, then call us. If there's a little opening, if there's an opening that's an inch long and it's not too wide, you could always put Neosporin on it. You could maybe put a Band-Aid on top of that if possible, if it stays on. And then if it's overnight, then call us in the morning. As long as if there's an open incision, that's okay. And there could be a little bit of discharge, a little bit of bleeding, which you could put light pressure on if there is. But if you see any tissue or anything coming out of the incision, that would be a case that you would want to come right in or call the emergency clinic or seek additional care, which is very unlikely. But especially for an abdominal incision that goes into the abdomen, if you see tissue coming out of the incision, then we consider that a medical emergency, and then that's a reason that you would go right in. But look for gaps in the incision. There can be swelling. There can be swelling of tissue. The tissue can be swollen, or there can be swelling underneath the incision. So the skin is bubbled up. Most of the time, if there's swelling under the incision, most of the time they'll feel soft and fluid-filled, and it will be serum. And if serum builds up under the incision, that's most common. That can happen, and that's most common on the incisions and areas where there's high movement. If there's an incision next to a joint and there's movement, if it's a dog that's very active or a young puppy, sometimes we'll see serum build up under the incision. The way to know that it's serum is with serum, it would be like really, really watered down blood. So maybe red tinge, but it'd be almost like water consistency. So there could be a drop or two of that, but with serum under the incision, it's not painful. So it's not painful to the touch when you touch it. The animal's still feeling good, still active, still willing to eat. So if all the other indications are normal, and if your pet is feeling good and there's just a swelling, then you can call us. If it is one of these seromas where it's just a serum buildup under the skin, that is something that goes away. That's something that goes away. It can take 2 weeks to 4 weeks for that to go away, but it will slowly be reabsorbed by the body. And it's important when you see those to limit activity even more, because the more active they are, the more likely they are to develop these. But I know it can be hard to keep a dog inactive. So opening of the incision, swelling of the incision, there can be some bleeding. And with any kind of incision on a pet, pets are likely to lick at it, they're likely to be active and be moving around, and their blood pressure's up. And if there's motion at the incision site or anywhere near the incision site, there's motion on the skin, those can potentially have some bleeding. If they have some bleeding, if it's an abdominal incision, it's very different than an incision under the skin. So if there's some sort of tumor, for example, somewhere on the body that we make an incision and take it off, versus something in the abdomen, which would be like a spay procedure, if there's bleeding from a spay procedure and it's a very small amount, and the animal's feeling good and they're eating well and they're bright and alert and they're not painful and they're able to walk around, if all the other signs look good, then you can limit their activity, you can put direct pressure on the incision, and that's okay, just gentle direct pressure, maybe with a towel or a paper towel, just direct pressure, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, sit with your pet. You can sit and watch TV or sit with your pet and talk to it and have direct pressure on it. That's one way to help. If it continues bleeding, that it is something that you may have to call. And if you need to call, call us. If we're not there, and you may have to call the emergency clinic. Bleeding postoperatively is very uncommon, but can potentially happen, especially if it's on a paw. Say it's on a paw, on a foot pad. If we have to take part of a foot pad off because there's a tumor, that's something that they step on a lot. There's a lot of motion, a lot of hitting at the incision. It's possible to have some bleeding. Direct pressure is usually what solves that problem. One thing you can check if you're concerned that you don't know if there's too much bleeding or not, you can lift up their gums and look at their gum color, and lift up their lips and look at their gum color. The gum color should be pink. And it's good to know how their normal gum color looks. So maybe if you see this video, just lift up the lip and take a look at the gum color to see what the normal color of the gums are. If they're losing too much blood, they get very light pink or even white. So if you see the gums light pink or white, you see a lot of bleeding, your pet is very weak, having trouble standing, not active at all, those are all signs that, of course, you need to seek medical attention immediately. But again, if there's a little bit of bleeding, direct pressure is okay, especially if your pet is feeling good and eating well and doing well in every other way. Pain at the incision. Pain, they can be painful at the incision, whether it's here, no matter where it is. They can be painful. We send home with every patient pain medicine, and the pain medicine, the directions on the label, of course, it depends on the patient, which medication we send home, what the frequency is, but the frequency is on the label, and it will say, for example, it might say one tablet twice a day as needed for pain, and that means if there's pain there, you can continue it. If you think your pet's feeling good and doesn't experience any pain, you can stop it. And then if you think after waiting a day that you see any more pain again, you can start it back up again. With some patients, you have to be careful, because if you give the pain medicine all the time, they may feel so good that they may become more active, or they could lick or chew at the incision, and if it doesn't hurt at all, they're curious enough that they may do more damage. So I'd always balance that. We don't want our patients to be in pain, but we also don't want them to feel so good that they're very active and that they hurt themselves due to their activity. And licking, of course, licking or chewing at the incision, that we definitely want to discourage. We find that most patients, if they do not have one of the collars, the Elizabethan collar or e-collar, most patients without a collar do not chew at their sutures, do not open up their wound, but it's possible. So you have to watch them. That goes on an individual basis, so there's no way to know for sure. So if there's a lot of licking or chewing, the things you can do, if the incision is on the body somewhere, you can actually put a t-shirt on them. And a t-shirt can help prevent them from getting to the incision. So that's one thing that can help. Another thing you can do is you can buy bitter apple or bitter orange spray, and you can spray it. You can either spray it on a paper towel and blot it around the incision, or spray it around the incision. And then those just taste bad, so that helps keep them away from it. And is licking at the incision, another way to help prevent that is to have them, when you're there with them, to have them in the same room with you, especially the first couple of nights, to just kind of keep an eye on them and see what they do, because every animal's different. Some animals will chew at their incisions, some animals don't do it at all, and it really just depends on the pet. So that's something to keep an eye out for if you think there's a concern or a problem, or if you think they are licking at it, then it's definitely important to call and get one of the collars or get some bitter apple spray. The one other type of collar we have is an inflatable collar, and it's like a donut that goes around their neck, so it makes it harder for them to turn around and lick at areas. So that's another thing that you can get to help. The next thing I'd like to talk about is their activity level. And of course, that's a common question and something that's very important to be addressed post-operatively. Activity level, it's always important to limit an animal's activity after they've had anesthesia or after they've had surgery. So there are a couple of different situations. And one is where they have their teeth cleaned and they don't have any loose teeth that have to be extracted. So I have their teeth cleaned. So they've had anesthesia, they go home the same day. That night it's very important that you limit their activity, keep them in a warm place. Even a dark place is preferable, because then they're likely to sleep it off. Be better for them to not be climbing or running too much that night. But then the next day, it's okay if they're more active. If they had their teeth cleaned and they had no extractions, no complications, no other incisions. So that's one scenario, and that night I would limit their activity. Limiting their activity means keeping them in the house. If they go outside, having them on a leash so they're not running, they're not jumping, they're not playing. The other scenario that we see is an animal that's had extractions, so it's had teeth extracted, or had an incision somewhere on their body. And of course there's a wide variety with incisions, anything from an abdominal surgery, which that's more important to limit them for a longer period of time, or a surgery if they have a lump or a tumor that has to be removed. That can be something that's very small too. Some animals will have a large tumor. So the longer the incision, the bigger the surgery, which is an abdominal surgery, a surgery in the chest, a surgery in the mouth, which are very vascular areas. If you think of some of the vascular areas, surgery of the tail, surgery of the lips, surgery of the ear flaps, those, if there's movement or activity, they're much more likely to have bleeding. So limiting their activity is very helpful in that kind of scenario. Or if the incision is a longer one, or if the surgery is a bigger one, if there's a tumor removal and it's a larger tumor on your animal, then it's more important to limit their activity. And for any type of procedure, such as a teeth cleaning where they've had extractions, the reason we want to limit their activity, one is if they have an incision, the more motion you have at the skin site, the more likely it is to open, the slower it is to heal, the more likely it is to bleed. So those are potential complications with activity. The more likely they are to have the fluid pocket, the seroma under the skin. So all those things can happen, and the likelihood increases with increased activity. And when they have a procedure where they have their teeth cleaned, if they have to have teeth extracted, the more active they are, their heart beats faster, their blood pressure goes up higher, and the more likely they may have some non-life-threatening bleeding from the site. If an animal has a tooth extracted, and it could have a drop or two of blood, just like we could. So you may see that, so be aware of that. If they lick themselves and it's a white dog, it'd be very apparent, and maybe it's a scary thing to see. But if you ever see blood, first look where it's coming from, look at the site it's coming from, and then think about, if possible, just putting some gentle direct pressure on it, firm direct pressure, to try to stop it for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and many times that will do the trick, so the blood vessel can clot. When they're active, any of the blood vessels, the little blood vessels that have blood clots on them, the blood clot can open up. If they're active, if they bump it, if they move too much, that can open up a blood clot. It can start to bleed a little bit. So that's activity level. The next thing is appetite. And a common question is, when can I feed my pet? It's coming home from a procedure that it's had that day. Anytime your pet has had a procedure that day and has had anesthesia, it's really important to limit the food. If after anesthesia the same day, just like for a person, if they eat too much too fast, if they drink too much too fast, they can get sick to their stomach just because they had anesthesia. It may not be any reaction to anything. It may just be because their body's still recovering from the anesthesia and their stomach needs a little break. So the same night as the procedure, it's okay to give water in small amounts, and if they hold it down, then you can give more. Food, most of the time we don't feed the same night of a procedure. We wait till the next morning. If you do feed them that night, if it wasn't a big procedure, if they look bright and alert, they're feeling good, they look totally normal, then you could start out by giving them 10 to 20% of the normal quantity of food. So the normal type of food, but 10 to 20% of the normal quantity, you could give them that small amount and see if they're interested in eating it. If they don't want to eat it, that's fine. Wait till the next day. If they do eat it and they hold it down, then maybe after an hour or two, you could offer a little bit more, or you could wait till the next day, but probably less is better until the next day, just because they had anesthesia that day. If they've had a procedure in their mouth where they've had a tumor removal on a lip or on their tongue or in their mouth somewhere, or they've had a tooth extracted or their teeth cleaned, they may be a little bit sensitive in their mouth. And if they're not wanting to eat, especially the next morning, then consider giving soft food. And if you feed them that same night, give them just a small amount of soft food, canned food, dry food that you water down and make sure is really soft, something that's soft so it's just not as abrasive in the area that they just had worked on. So that's appetite. And if your dog is not eating by the next day, give us a call. May not eat that night, but also keep in mind that some dogs are more finicky than others. Some dogs are not good eaters and they've never been good eaters. So those are dogs that may take, dogs or cats, that may take a little bit longer to start eating normally after a procedure. Dogs that are good eaters, with they're very good eaters all the time, and they're not eating a day, that's a little bit more significant. So keep that in mind and be aware of that. Try different types of food, and if they're not wanting to eat, then give us a call. And finally, the medication. So when your pet comes home from a procedure, there are a couple types of medication. There are many possibilities because your pet may also have an ear infection, a skin infection, something else going on. But in general, the two types of medication that we give when they go home, one is a pain medicine. And the pain medicine, it depends on what it is. It could be Torbutrol. It could be Tramadol, it could be Metprofen, it could be Rimadyl. There are a bunch of different potential ones, and we'll pick the best one based on your pet's needs, based on the procedure it had, and that will dictate the type of medicine and how frequently your pet gets the medicine. But what will be on the label will be something, for example, one tablet twice a day as needed for pain. And what does that mean, as needed for pain? Well, there are several ways to look for it, several things you should look for to see if your pet's in pain. If your pet's in pain, it will be less active, but if it had a procedure that night, it will probably be less active, and that's okay, but it would be less active. It'd be sensitive to the touch in the area that it had the procedure done. It may be hiding or stay away from the family. Those are all things to look for. There may be subtle signs of discomfort. shaking, crying, of course, but many times that may not happen. Most pets after procedures just need pain medicine for a day or two in general. If it's a bigger procedure, maybe even 3 or 4 days of pain medicine, could need longer. So just keep an eye on your pet. If you're not sure, if you're looking for these things and you're not sure if your pet's in pain, probably isn't. If it's eating well, it's moving around well, wanting to run outside and you're having the limited activity and you can't tell if it's in pain, it's much less likely that it is in pain. So look for those things, and if you have any questions, call us. And that answers some of the most common post-operative questions. Hope this is helpful. Have a great day.